We have discussed mutex and semaphores as tools for synchronization to provide mutually exclusive access to critical sections and also integrity of the shared data. However, even with the use of mutex and semaphores, it is possible that you have very significant problems in programming, basically deadlocks and starvation due to deadlocks. So what's a deadlock? A deadlock is a case where you have two or more processes that are waiting indefinitely, not for a long time, indefinitely. So there is no way actually that after waiting long enough, some of those processes will complete and the rest can continue. It is not possible. So in the case of a deadlock, two or more processes are waiting for each other indefinitely. So none of them will have any progress and none of them will complete. Therefore, there will be starvation. So let's, for example, consider two semaphores, S and Q. And let's also assume that there are two processes, P0 and P1, that need both of these semaphores. Now, why would you have two separate semaphores? For example, let's assume a scenario where process P0 is reading from a file and populating an array in memory by what it has read from the file. So if, for example, semaphore S would be for providing mutually exclusive access to the file, whereas Q could be protecting the array in the memory. And let's assume that P1 is trying to do something reverse. It's reading from the array and writing to the file. Okay? So in programming, the author of the first program for P0 could first request the semaphore for S for the file, and then the semaphore for the memory. Once the programmer has acquired both of the semaphores, he or she would implement all the code that's necessary for all those operations, and when done, would signal both S and Q. Whereas on the other hand, the same programmer or another programmer, doesn't matter, could be acquiring these two locks in the reverse order, Q and S, and then do whatever is necessary, and when done, signal Q and S. Now the problem that arises is as follows. Note that in many cases, you will not even realize that there is a problem because you will not hit this specific scenario, hit this specific order of execution of the statements. But still, since the it's up to the scheduler to decide when P0 is removed from the CPU and P1 goes into the CPU. So it is the scheduler who decides the preemption of the processes. It is possible that in one execution of these two processes, the scheduler first assigns P0 to the CPU. P0 executes the first statement, wait S. It was successful, so it has acquired the semaphore S, but before calling wait Q, the operating system, the scheduler, decides to do a context switch to, let's say, process P1. And the first thing P1 does is it says wait Q. And that semaphore is also available. So P1 is also successful. So note that at this very moment, P0 has S, P1 has Q. And the next statement of P1 is wait for the semaphore S, which is acquired by P0. So P1 gets blocked here. It starts sleeping because S is at the moment in the hands of P0. So since P1 is sleeping, the scheduler will not schedule P1 anymore. It will go to other processes. At some point, the scheduler will allow P0 to proceed, and P0 will try to acquire the semaphore for Q, which is actually currently owned by process P1. So P0 cannot continue. It has to wait for the semaphore Q to become available, which is held by P1. But unfortunately, P1 is sleeping on S. Here, actually, P1 is waiting for P0 to release S, which is waiting for P1 to release Q. But since P1 cannot proceed, it cannot release Q. So P0 has to wait. And since P0 is waiting and sleeping, it cannot release S. Therefore, P1 cannot proceed either. So P0 is waiting for P1. P1 is waiting for P0. And none of them is able to proceed. So at the moment, we have what we call a deadlock between these two processes, P0 and P1. But note that if this happens in your computer system, you will realize that two of your processes are actually locked in a deadlock. P0 and P1 cannot proceed. But with the rest of the operating system, you don't have any problems, because specifically those two processes are waiting for each other. But the other processes are not related to these two processes, so they can proceed. So in this case, P0 and P1, since they're not progressing at all, they will go into what we call indefinite blocking or indefinite postponement. Therefore, those two processes will never get into the CPU, and we will say they are starving. Starving, and actually such problems is a quite important problem, especially in the case of real-time systems. You have very significant problems with this. For example, in the case of the Mars rover, what happened was the system in the rover, while in Mars, it suddenly started rebooting, and they couldn't understand in NASA why it was rebooting. The rover integrity would work for some time and then reboot, again work, reboot, work, reboot. This could not be understood. Finally, what they realized was one process, a low priority process, was holding a lock on a resource which was acquired by a process with higher priority. So although one process with higher priority was trying to get a resource, normally it should be able to get it, but unfortunately a lower priority process had already acquired that process, and sorry, that resource. So the higher priority process was waiting and waiting and waiting, and there was a watchdog that was checking for such problems. And when it realizes that a high priority process had been waiting for so long, it would just reboot the system to solve the problem. It was not able to properly solve that contention there, but by rebooting the computer system, by rebooting the rover, the watchdog process was hoping that this deadlock would be broken. It was actually broken, but since the problem remained there, soon it would fall into the same deadlock once again. So again reboot, again fall into the deadlock problem. And this problem was later solved by an update in the software, which employs what we call priority inheritance protocol. So a low priority process can even get a higher priority when necessary, but we'll not go into that detail, but just know that there is such a problem. Now, the classical problems with synchronization Can be explained by making by explaining three problems that are actually quite similar to each other. These are the bounded buffer, readers and writers problem, and the dining philosophers problems. We'll be looking into these problems one by one. For the bounded buffer problem, we have this, remember that consumer producer problem we discussed earlier. So similar problem, we have some limited number of buffers. Let's assume n buffer places where you can place a single item in each position. We need to access this shared buffer. So we need to protect the shared buffer, and that we will do by a mutex, which is initialized one. Initially, we will have a semaphore for full and semaphore for empty. The full semaphore is initial zero because all positions are, there are actually no full positions, they're all empty. Therefore, empty is initialized to n. So the bounded buffer problem could simply be implemented as follows. We're currently looking at the producer process. In the producer process, you have the empty and mutex semaphores called. So first of all, to produce something, you should make sure that you have an empty slot in the buffer. Because otherwise, when you produce the item, you will have no place to put the item. So that's why we first call the semaphore on empty. If that's successful, that means you have a reserved now position in the buffer. Now you should call mutex, because you're going to deal with the buffer, and you put the item that you have produced earlier here into the corresponding buffer space. And when you're done, first release the mutex on the buffer and then signal full. So what we have done is we have, when we call wait on empty, remember we decrement the empty semaphore, which was originally initialized to n by one. So it has become n minus one because you have now one less space that's empty. And when you have placed the item into the buffer, you call signal full, which was initialized to zero. So you increment that one by one. But note that we signal full just when the item has been properly placed into the buffer. You don't want to signal full while you're in the process of placing it in the buffer, because at that case it's in an incomplete state. And the mutex here is guaranteeing that only one process is able to place something in the buffer at any time to avoid collisions. On the consumer side, now you cannot attempt to consume anything until there is at least one item available in the buffers. That's why we call wait full. Remember, originally in the initial conditions, full was zero. So if it was first the consumer process that was working, the consumer would be stuck here until a producer produces something. If something is being produced, if there's something in the buffer, then you're going to access the buffer, so you want mutual exclusion. And once you get the mutex here, you can go ahead and remove the item from there and release the mutex, and then you should increment the number of available positions in the buffer by one by calling signal empty, because you have consumed one item. So with wait full here, we have decremented the number of full positions in the buffer, and with signal empty, we increment the number of empty positions in the buffer. Note that this system of producer and consumer processes here in the bounded buffer problem, allows us to have multiple producers and multiple consumers. So it's not like one producer, one consumer process. You can have, for example, K producer processes and say M consumer processes. They will be able to work properly without any problems when we use the full empty and mutex as mentioned in these slides. So this is the case of a bounded buffer. We have limited N buffer places. Reader's writer's problem is very similar to the producer-consumer problem. We have a shared data set between several, again, processes. Some of these processes are readers. So that means they're just trying to read from the data set, but they're not modifying the data itself. They're just, in other words, they just have read-only access to the data. This is actually how it is different from the consumer process we had earlier in the producer-consumer problem. Because in the case of the consumer process here, you were modifying the buffer, you were modifying the data. Here, the readers do not make any modifications, but still, they should make sure that nothing is being written while you're writing, because it would cause inconsistencies. The writer processes, note that you can have multiple readers and multiple writers. The writers are allowed to both read and write from this data structure, from this data set. Now the problem is how to allow multiple readers at the same time, because since the readers have only read-only access, why don't we allow multiple readers read from the data set at the same time? This will improve the system's overall performance and would not cause any harm because the readers are not making any modifications. However, you cannot make the same assumption for the writers. You can have only one writer at a time. You cannot have two processes write to the data set at the same time because this will cause inconsistencies. Furthermore, you should not allow a writer and one or more readers at the same time, because while someone is trying to read, the writer could be actually modifying the data. So the reader might have read some inconsistent data because while it was reading, part of the data was overwritten, part was not. So in a nutshell, we should allow multiple readers at a time, but only one writer at any point in time. And even a single writer should not overlap with the readers. There are several variations of the readers and writers are considered. So what we are going to do is we will have this shared data set. We will have a read-write mutex initialized to one, another mutex initialized again to one, and the read count, which is initialized to zero. Read count is the number of readers currently reading from this data set. So initially, there is nothing, no readers are reading initially. So that's why it's initialized to zero. The read-write mutex will ensure that there's either one writer and no one else, or if someone is reading, then the writer should wait until those readers have completed their reading operations. And the mutex will ensure we have mutual exclusion while we are dealing with these data structures. Now, there are variations into the readers-writers problem. So in the first variation, no reader is kept waiting unless a writer has permission to write to the shared data. And in the second variation, once the writer is ready, you would like to allow the writer do the writing as soon as possible. In both cases, you may have starvation leading to even more variations. So you can have more variations than these two. And the problem is solved on some systems by kernel providing the reader-writer locks. Now, let's see a solution. We have, again, the writer process and reader process implemented separately. Let's start with the writer process, which is much shorter. You want to write something to the data? Well, you should first get the lock, the read-write mutex. Okay, so we want mutual exclusion in that sense. Either one and only one, not remember, not multiple writer processes. Only one writer process can write at a time. That's why we call wait read-write mutex. Once you get it, you can write to the write over the data set and then signal it. Okay, but also keep in mind that if one writer process is writing, you don't even want to allow reader processes. So that's why in the case of the reader process, we will also make use of the read-write mutex, as you see in here. Now, you want to read from the data set, you should get the read-write mutex, as I mentioned, which will ensure that there are no writers if someone is reading. However, if there is already there are some readers in the system, new reader processes need not wait for this mutex, because one of them has ensured that the writer cannot write. So the second, third, fourth reader processes can enter their critical sections, which is accessing the data set to read, without waiting for the mutex, because one of them has acquired that read-write mutex for the whole reader group. Similarly, when we're done with, when all readers are done with the reading process, the last reader should release this lock. Okay? That's why we're checking on the read count. Remember, read count was initially 0. So you make it 1, you increment it. So the first reader increments it, so it becomes 1. Since it's the first reader, read count is equal to 1 is true. So it will wait on the read-write mutex. If a writer was writing to the data, even the first reader has to block and wait until the until the writer process is completed. But once the writers, none of the writers is writing on the data, this wait will complete. So now pay attention, not the writer, but a reader process has acquired the mutex, okay? Acquired the read-write mutex, sorry. Since this operation is based on read count, which is shared between all reader processes, we should protect read count. And that's what mutex does. This mutex, wait mutex, and signal mutex is actually ensuring that only one reader process is allowed to do this operation at a time. Because, as I said, again, the read count is a shared variable between the reader processes, multiple of them. Therefore, it should be provided with a mutex. That's what this mutex does. Pay attention, this mutex is different from the read-write mutex. That's another mutex. Read-write mutex was between the reader and writer processes. Mutex is just for protecting the read count. Anyways, if we come to this point, what we know is there are no writers in the system, and there's at least one reader at the moment. So that reader can do the reading. While that reader is reading, let's say process R1, let's say, for the reader. While R1 is reading, let's say another reader process, R2, wants to read. It will try to get the mutex. It can get the mutex because R1 is currently reading the data. It's here, it has signaled mutex, and it's not dealing with mutex. So R2 can get the mutex. It increments the number of counters to 2. 2 is not equal to 1. that means someone, another reader, has already acquired the read-write mutex. So R2 does not need to check the read-write mutex. In fact, even if it did, it would get stuck there because it is held by R1. So it shouldn't. That's why we do this only for the first reader, not the following readers. Anyways, R2 will just skip over this wait. It's getting out of this protected area, so it's just signaling mutex. And R2 also enters its critical section to read the data. Let's say meanwhile R3 comes in. Similar to R2, it will skip this wait here, and that will also enter this critical section. Meanwhile, let's say R1 completes its critical section. So it wants to decrement read count by one because it's not reading anymore. But remember, we should be protecting read count with a mutex as we do in here, wait and signal mutex. And when R1 completes, it checks if it's the if it was the only reader. If it was the only reader, read count would decrement. With this decrement, it would become zero. So it would release the read-write mutex so that a writer may now start writing if a writer was waiting. However, since R2 and R3 had already entered, so read count was 3, when R1 decrements read count, it will just become 2. So 2 is equal to 0 is false, so it will not release read-write mutex. Therefore, if there was a writer process that was waiting for the readers to stop to complete their reading operations, it still has to wait because there's still two reader processes. When R2 completes, read count will be 1. Again, it will not release read-write mutex. But when R3 completes, read count will be decremented from 1 down to 0. Remember, R3 was the last one, last reader. Therefore, it will release the read-write mutex. Pay attention. The read-write mutex was acquired by R1. It is released by R3 because R1 acquired the read-write mutex for the set of all readers. And R3 is releasing it for the set of all readers. And after that, if there was a waiting writer process, now it might continue. Now with the dining philosopher's problem, let's assume that the philosophers spend their lives in two states, in two alternating states. They're either thinking or eating, doing nothing else, just like professors. So we will assume that these philosophers are sitting on a round table. For the sake of the example, we will assume there are five such philosophers. So they're all sitting around a round table, and there is a bowl of rice in the middle. So the philosophers are waiting, sitting here, sorry. And there are only five chopsticks on the table. And to eat the rice, a professor needs two chopsticks. You cannot eat with a single chopstick, okay? So also, of course, we are assuming that the professor is not allowed, for example, this professor is not allowed to go and pick up this one. So you can only pick up the chopstick to your left and to your right. Disgusting enough, each chopstick is shared between two side-by-side professors. So in other words, this professor eats using these chopsticks. This professor cannot eat meanwhile because this chopstick is already taken by this one. So it has to wait until this philosopher here, sorry, not professor, philosopher here is full. So the philosopher leaves the chopsticks on the table. And this time, for example, this philosopher can pick up this one, and if available, this one, so it can go ahead and eat. But note that when this chopstick becomes available, this one has been taken, then this guy again has to wait. So we have some shared data, the bowl of rice that we want to access, we want to eat from, and the more important thing for us will be these chopsticks. We have five of them. So we will have an array of chopsticks, each initialized to one, denoting that that chopstick is available. If you want to also, this array of chopsticks could also be Boolean, doesn't matter. So the structure of the code for some philosopher I would be like, you should wait for the chopstick to your left. So wait for chopstick I. You should wait for the chopstick to your right, I plus one. But since it's a round table, we will take this I plus one and apply modulo 5, because we have five chopsticks. If this wait is successful, that means the professor picks up chopstick one. And if the professor can pick up chopstick two, then that philosopher can start eating. It takes some time to eat, but once the philosopher is full, he or she will release the chopsticks one by one by calling signal and spend some time thinking. And too much thinking causes the philosopher to get hungry again. So again, we'll try to pick up chopsticks and eat in a loop. And that's what the philosopher is doing. Now, this solution sounds logical, but there are some problems with this. For example, take it this way. One second, let me get my pen once again. Let's assume the chopsticks are enumerated as 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4. Remember, we have 5 of them. Okay. And let me enumerate the philosophers with letters. Okay, this is A, B, C, D, and E. Now, assume A wants to eat. So A will take this one and this one. So the marked chopsticks are in use at the moment. So A can read. Sorry, A can eat. That's why I have this check mark. B cannot eat, okay, because this is in use. C can eat, so it will take this one and this one, okay. D cannot eat, E cannot eat. Okay. Now, in this, so we said, sorry, C can eat. Let me also put the check mark for that one. Okay. So after some time, if A can, if A is full, A will release these chopsticks and B can proceed. Actually B cannot proceed because C is also holding the chopsticks. Okay, C is holding number 2. So B will still have to wait. The problem arises when, similar to the previous deadlock, because this is also a deadlock situation, the problem arises when one philosopher picks up a chopstick, the left one, okay, and wants to get the right chopstick, and it cannot because it's already in use. So now what happens? The philosopher is waiting with the chopstick in hand, Okay, but the philosopher cannot proceed because it cannot get the other one. Now, consider this scenario. So let me change the scenario slightly. Let me make everything available once again. So at the moment, all chopsticks are available. Nobody is eating at the moment. A gets hungry. So first picks the left chopstick. Sorry. Okay. Before A picks its right chopstick, B also gets hungry. Suddenly all professors, or philosophers, sorry, get hungry at the same time. So it is possible, not very likely, but it is possible. So B also gets the left chopstick. Sorry, where did the... I had already marked. A gets hungry, so it picks one. B gets hungry, it picks two. C gets hungry, picks three. D gets hungry, picks four. E gets hungry, picks zero. Okay? Now, this is because A, B, C, D, E, they all got hungry at the same time. They all picked their left chopsticks. How can one get the right chopstick? Now note that all chopsticks are in the hands of a philosopher, but no philosopher is able to get the second chopstick. So they are all stuck, they are all in a deadlock, and literally these dining philosophers will starve to death because they cannot get the right chopsticks. So that was the problem with this piece of code. Again, you might say, how likely is it that all philosophers just get hungry at the same time? It is not very likely, but in computer science, as you know, the Murphy rule works. If something can go wrong, it will. But the code being executed so many times, the probability that something with a very low probability happens is likely. Okay, so it could happen at some point in time. So that's why it will not always get stuck, but sometimes it will. So we should have some mechanisms for dealing with deadlocks. For example, one solution would be, although there are five seats in this round table, you allow at most four philosophers to be sitting simultaneously. It works. The condition I explained, all philosophers picking the chopsticks, you would not have that problem because this time you're not allowing the fifth guy to sit on the table. So the guy will not be able to pick the chopstick to its left. Sorry, let me erase this one. So E will not be able to acquire chopstick zero. Therefore, although B, C, and D cannot proceed, at least A can. So A can take chopstick zero. It already had chopstick one. So A can at least eat while B, C, and D are watching. Not very nice of A. But still, at some point, hopefully, A will be full. So it will release both of the chopsticks. So now B can get one. Now B can eat. When it's full, it will release these. And C can eat. Then D can eat. It can work this way. Okay, so there is a way out of this. Or you can have a philosopher pick up the chopstick only if both of them are available. But this time you need a critical section to check both of the chopsticks. So in a mutually exclusive manner, the philosopher checks left chopstick, right chopstick, they're both available, you get both of them. If not both of them are available, you don't get any one of them. So like if the left chopstick was available but right was not available, you don't even attempt to take the left chopstick because anyways you're not going to be able to eat. Okay, so you leave, you don't pick up the left chopstick so that the philosopher to your left might use that chopstick because anyways you're not able to eat. But this introduces another problem. I could be very unlucky if I'm sitting next to two philosophers who get hungry often. I will sometimes wait for the philosopher on my right to release the right chopstick so that I can eat. But since I'm not allowed to pick up my pick and hold my left chopstick meanwhile, I will just be waiting for that guy without any chopsticks in hand before my right chopstick becomes available. The guy to my left starts eating. So when the right chopstick becomes available, left is occupied. Waiting for left, the right guy again starts eating. So I will never ever be able to find two chopsticks available at the same time. So I will be waiting for a long time and I would be starving in that case. Another solution is using an asymmetric solution where the odd-numbered philosophers pick first the left chopstick, then the right one, and the even-numbered philosophers pick them in the reverse order. So remember, we had philosophers A, B, C, D, E. So A goes as first left, then right, but B goes as first right, then left. This will also solve the problem. So that's yet another solution to that problem. But deadlock is more complex. We will be discussing it in a separate chapter, in the next chapter, actually. There are, by the way, various other problems with semaphores because the concept of semaphores requires that you use these signal and wait functions properly. For example, remember, you should first wait. When you pass through the wait function, you go into your critical section, then you signal. What if you make a typo and you first signal, then wait? You mess up with everything. Before entering the critical section, when you use the mutex, remember, it was originally one, you were supposed to take it down to zero with wait. Instead, you make it 1, 2. Okay? So this is a possible error and it will cause you a lot of problems. Just a typo. Similarly, if you just use wait and then rather than signaling, you use wait, again, a serious problem. Or you get the wait, get the mutex with wait, you forget to signal it. Or you forget to use wait, then you signal it. Or you don't use wait or signal at all. These are all programming errors that you could easily make. So these are possible problems with the semaphores. In the next section, we will be discussing another concept, the concept of monitors, which just provides us a structured way of making use of these shared variables that will actually prevent such programming errors.